Hi, and thank you for stopping by our YouTube channel. To follow along with the sermon, download the My Sermon Notes app in the link below. For more sermons like this, go to citygatechurch.us. Enjoy, and God bless you.
The title of tonight's sermon is Man, That Was Close. And I'm going to share something with you that happened to me last night. Most of you know, or all of you know, that my dad has not been doing very well at all. And dealing with prostate cancer and Parkinson's and AFib and everything that's gone on there. Yesterday morning, Travis and Melissa were going to Cleveland to take care of some business and to be able to visit with mom and dad, so it was a twofold thing. I didn't know Melissa was going, so I volunteered to go with Travis so he didn't have to drive by himself. So I got up yesterday morning and I kept Jeff Henley's hours. I got up at 3:15. And when I got home last night, it was about 6 o'clock yesterday evening. And we had driven to Cleveland to visit and take care of the business and then come home. As I was walking in the door, my telephone rang. And I still had things in my hand and I saw the name that was on it. And it was Big Chris. And I answered the phone and he said, "Can you come to the hospital right now?" I said, "Yes, sir, I'm on my way." I knew it was an urgent situation. I felt my face and I knew that I needed to shave and I didn't take time to do that. I put my stuff down in my chair. I kissed my wife and she said, "Hi, bye," literally. And I went and got in the truck and I drove to the hospital. I walked in the door of the lobby of the ICU and there was Big Chris and all of his family and everybody was in tears. And I asked what was going on. They said that his father was bleeding internally and that it was from his esophagus and they could not get it to stop and they had been putting more blood in him. And they just kept putting more blood in him, but it was coming out of him quicker than they could put it in him. The doctor came out and he said, "We got the bleeding stopped. If anybody wants to see him, do you want to come in?" Chris reached out and he grabbed me and he said, "Let's go." And I went with Chris into the room with his father. And I went in that room and I saw They warned us before we went in because of the amount of blood that was coming back from his body. They had him basically mummified except for his face, and they had him cleaned up as well as they could. And I looked at the numbers on the machines. It just didn't look good. I spent a lot of time in hospitals. I don't know what all those numbers mean, but those numbers that I saw were not good numbers. Does that make sense? And I knelt down and I prayed. I put my hand on his leg and I just started praying. And y'all know how big Chris is. When I say big Chris, that's no joke. That's a big boy. And I felt what felt like a manhole cover reach down and touch me on my shoulder as I was praying. And when I felt him touch me, it broke me into tears. And I began to cry and I began to pray. And I said, "God, this is not about me. It's not about what I can do. Because I know how messed up I am. It's about what you can do and who you are." And I didn't pray that out loud. I'm just sharing my prayer with you. I got up and I went with Chris and we went out. We brought some more of the family in and back and forth and back and forth. And we were waiting on his brother to come. And he was able to get there. We were all in the room together. Chris asked me, he said, "Do you want to pray again?" I prayed several times with the family. He said, "Do you want to pray again?" I said, "Absolutely. Y'all know me. When it comes to praying, I'm down. I'm ready to pray." And I said, "We're going to do this the way I do it." We all held hands. They held their daddy's hand. Now, you may agree with this theology. You may disagree with this theology, and I'm okay with it, guys. I want you to know that. I'm just telling you what I witnessed. He was not responsive at all. And I kept telling the family, he can hear you. Make sure you talk to him. He can hear you. That's been proven, by the way. People that can't respond, they can still hear. So they were doing the family thing. And Chris asked me to pray, and I did. And this was my prayer. I said, Father, as I normally do, I thank you for the day. And Lord, if this man has anything that he needs to be forgiven of, I ask you to forgive him right now. Now, I wasn't praying for him. I was praying with him because I knew he could hear me. Does everybody understand where I'm going with this? And I said, I ask you, Father, as we commend him into your spirit, to accept his forgiveness and to usher him into your presence. Before I said that, I said, John's here, and I thank you for the family all being here. I prayed, and I said, in the name of Jesus, amen. And when I said amen, there was a deep breath and a release, and I watched the numbers start dropping, going lower and lower and lower. And I watched the heartbeat as it was doing its normal thing across the screen, do this, and then get slower, until it was a flat line. And Wayne was gone. It all happened within 5 minutes. Man, that was close. I'm having a real hard time tonight because Wayne was a friend. We've known him for years. Our boys grew up together from, kindergarten, first grade. We weren't like buddy pals, but we knew each other and we were very cordial with each other always. And I had a lot of respect for him. Hard working man. And I said to the family, did you notice what just happened after that prayer? And the daughter spoke up and she said, I saw that. That's what I call confirmation. And guys, I'm saying to you this, I am not God. I don't decide who goes to heaven and who doesn't. I do not have that power, I don't have that authority, and I don't sit in the big chair. Everybody still with me? I don't get to make that call. I'm simply sharing with you what I saw, what I witnessed, and what I felt. Now, the Bible tells us to try the Spirit by the Spirit. And I'm going to challenge your thought process tonight with something, if I haven't already. Jesus was crucified, and there were two thieves, one on either side of him. One, we know, repented because he said something. But we have no more conversation after the fact. We don't know if the other man repented or not. We just know that the one man did. I'm going to share this with you because when we get to heaven, when I get to heaven, I can't speak for you, but I'm telling you right now, I know and I'm persuaded and I believe that my sins are under the blood of Jesus and that I am going to heaven. Amen. According to Scripture. According to Scripture, not what Howie thinks, but what I've read, what I believe, and what I understand, because my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life in the blood of Jesus. Amen. And I know that. 1 John 5:13 says, these things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. That tells me I can know. Amen? That's black and white. You look it up, 1 John 5:13. I don't care what version you read. Look it up. What I witnessed and what I saw led me to this. Friday, I called my childhood, the best childhood friend that I've ever had, which was a guy by the name of Stacy. Of course, we all had nicknames. He brought a guy named Shorty with him, which is not short, but we call him Shorty. And my son and my future daughter-in-law sit there and witnessed us telling stories about our past and the things that we did and all of those things. And Shorty turned and looked away, and when I looked at him, he had a scar from about right here to about right here in the back of his head. Been in a major accident. He was one of the dirt track racer guys. Been broke up pretty bad. And he made a statement. He said, "Howie, none of us should be here right now." Man, that was close. So I'm going to share tonight with you the scripture. And I'm going to ask you the first question. Are you ready? It's been close. How close are you willing to let it be? Are you ready? The Bible says in Matthew 24, 36 and through 44, "But of that day and hour no one knows, but even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will be the coming of the Son of Man." "For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be." Number two, are you sure? Are you sure? Are you ready? And if you say yes, and I hope you do, I want you to, but my next question is, are you sure? We've already spoken about 1 John 5:13, that we know that we can know according to Scripture that we have eternal life. Amen? The Bible then says, "Then two men will be in the field, and one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming." Are you paying attention? Number three, are you paying attention? Anybody notice the difference in our weather the last few days? How did it feel? For me, good. I like it when it gets cool. I like it. Becky walked across the parking lot of a business today with myself, and she and I were going in there to grab something, and she said, "Man, it's getting cool." I said, "Yeah, a day like this, you can work all day long, and it feels good." Those are the kind of days that I like to work when it's cooler like that. Because, you know, the insulation factor heats my body up. I'm just putting that out there. Bible goes on and says, "But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into." Have anybody ever been violated that way? Had something stolen from you? Had something taken from you? Had your house broken into? That's a horrible feeling. I went to look for something on my truck today, and it was gone. Somebody helped themselves to something that didn't belong to them. So whenever they use it, I hope it, like, their stuff gets messed up because they use something that's gone. Just putting that out there. I don't like people who steal. I don't like anybody stealing from me, and I don't steal from anybody. "Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." Now, I wanted to share this with you because at 6 o'clock last night, when I walked in the door of my house, I was ready to sit down and relax. I promise. I was tired. Anybody relate to that? Work all day long, come home tired, wore out, and the phone rings, and it's a telemarketer. And you're always so nice to them. I know, because y'all are Christians. Y'all are good people. Y'all love Jesus. I get it. Trust me, I get it. But when that phone rang last night and I saw whose name was there, now pay attention to me. When I saw the name that was there, it didn't matter what Howie had going on. I was going to help that person. And it's the same way when your names come up. Now I want you to pay real close attention to this. When we speak and we pray, God hears us and he feels the same way. When he hears your voice. Isaac talked about it last week. How many of y'all enjoyed that sermon last week? Man, that guy lit it up. You know, we saw the offering. $3,633. How amazing is that? You guys are awesome. You just are awesome. So I want to share this with you. It will be just like that. It's going to be, the Bible says, in the twinkling of an eye. But that's not the end of the story, guys. Number four, listen to God. Romans 10:8-13. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith, which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Number five, ask for forgiveness. Verse 10, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord, what does it say? Shall be saved. Now, what have I taught you about that one little word, shall? It will be. It will happen. It's a declaration. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Number six, receive the gift. Receive the gift. Revelation 3:20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him and he with me. Now in the King James, the word is not dine, it's sup. And if you look at this in its original text and its original position, it's the devouring of. In other words, we devour the word and the word devours us and we become one. Does that make sense? It's like eating something. Whatever you eat, you become one with. It becomes one with you. And it works to the good and for the good of your body to give you strength and nutrition and nourishment. And that's what the word is for. to strengthen us in our position. Now, whether we understand this, whether we believe this, whether we feel okay with this, I want you to know that I'm good with every person in this room. I love you. Every person on the internet, I love them. Jeff's video. The man's brother was just killed by a police officer, and he told the woman, I love you. I forgive you. I'm saying this to you so that you understand. I don't get to decide. As much as I love you, I don't get to decide whether you go to heaven or you don't. I don't get to decide that. If it was up to me, we would all go. But see, that's why God says, you look on the outward, I look on the inward. You see, it's the condition of the heart, guys. I want you to know, I'm not here to guilt anybody. And you know, I don't preach sermons like this a lot. But this moved me. What happened yesterday, it was so close. Guys, think about this. We've been in this room for an hour and 20 minutes or so, maybe 2 hours for some of us. 5 minutes. 5 minutes. In 5 minutes, I prayed with Wayne. I prayed with him. I'd been there for a couple of hours. I'd been in the room several times. I had prayed with him several times. And I prayed with him one last time. And within 5 minutes, I couldn't pray with him again. Because it was at that point that I knew for certain that he couldn't hear me. You see how close we are to eternity? How many of you have come close? I was thinking about Chris. When I was doing this sermon, I was thinking about you, Chris. And I was thinking about everything you've done for me. And how good a friend you are to me. And I thought about that rock. You know, I mean, yeah, it's a rock. And we made jokes. I made jokes. You know, because you heard them. But when that rock hits you in the head, if it would have hit you just right, we know that a rock smaller than that killed a giant. Are you guys following me tonight? A simple thing. Chris had no plan of getting hit with a rock, and I sure didn't have a plan for him to get hit with a rock. And I sure didn't have a plan to ride him to the emergency room and to stand with him and be with him when he went through that. I had no plan to go to the hospital with Jeff. I had no plan to go with you, Sue, or you, Mary, or with my wife, Becky. I had no plan to do any of that. But God had a plan. And I'm saying this to you so that you understand. The reason that I feel that that man is with God now is because God is so full of mercy. Amen. And the people in our lives that we love and we care about, that we want to know Jesus. Guys, do anything you want to me. But just don't die without him. Gain everything you want to gain. Do anything you want to do. I don't care. But don't die without him. Somebody said, but what if I live for Jesus and then I die and I'm just dead? And I don't get, there's no heaven, there's no hell, there's no nothing afterwards. I said, you know what? And I'm just going to be honest the way I said it. I said, at least you weren't a crappy person. How about that? That's fair, isn't it? So I'm saying this to you tonight so that you understand. I love you. There's nobody in this room that I wouldn't do anything that you asked me to do. If it was in my power, I would do anything you've asked me to do. And I don't believe that any of you have ever proven me not to give you my best effort to help you in any way that I possibly can. I may not meet your expectation, but I do what I can. Is that fair? But I also know that if I call on you, you will in return do the same for me. Because we are brothers and sisters. We are a family. No matter how much I love you, no matter how much I want you to be there, I can't do it for you. And it was a tough day when I learned the lesson that because I was Roy Cantrell's son, and that meant something in the world that I grew up in, because I could get in a lot of trouble and they would be ready to come down on me and they would say, "Who is your parents?" And I'd say, "Roy Cantrell's my father," and they would just let go and back up. And I started feeling a way about that. But you know what meant more to me than anything? Was to know that when somebody tries to hurt me now, and they say, "Who's your father?" I say, "The Lamb of God, Jesus. I'm a child of the King, bought with a price. I belong to Him." And I watch them try to grab, and I watch them not be able to pass the blood. And I also watch them grab me and do it and say whatever they want. But the Bible says that God's arm is not short, and He does not miss anything. Bow your heads tonight. Father, I thank you so much for this day. Lord, I thank you for the life of Wayne. I thank you for the lives of his children and his wife, for his grandchildren, Lord. I pray blessings upon that family, Lord. Healing, peace, comfort from your Holy Spirit. Father, I ask you right now if there's someone under the sound of my voice, that they would hear you. I'm going to do something a little different. I'm going to ask Jeff and April and Murph to go to the back of the room. If there's anybody here, continue to bow your heads. If there's anybody here that needs prayer, these people are in the back of the room to pray with you and to pray for you, no matter what it is, if it's a prayer request or if it's the salvation. If you want to give your life to Christ, or if you just want to go and have them to pray for something, they're there for you. Father, if there's anybody here under the sound of my voice that doesn't know you, Lord, I pray that you knock on that door and you give them the ability to open that door and accept the precious gift that you have. I thank you for being God all by yourself, for blessing, keeping, and caring for each and every one of us. I ask you, Father, to be with us, to hold our hands, Father, when we're unsteady, to carry us when we can't walk. We give you the praise. In the precious name of your Son, Jesus.